So next, we'll hear from Roy about, like Solan said, he had his police investigation on the same day and same time as Solan at the Cantonment Police Station. Okay, over to you, Roy.
Okay, thank you. Actually, I'm going to share a bit about my experience, how I actually did not handle it well, and also what I learned from it. I think just to start off, both Solan and I have not committed any crime or offence. It's clear under the Elections Act, because we were expressing our opinions as personal individuals who were writing on a non-commercial basis. I think if you look at previous politicians from PAP, Tin Pei Ling and Vivian Balakrishnan, they were candidates who were running for the election who did post on cooling off day, and they were the ones who have actually committed the crime. And if we were charged, they should be jailed. Okay, it's quite clear cut. So there is no basis for us to be even investigated in the first place. I would like to know if because the election department made a police report against us, whether it's actually an offence to make a police report knowing that it's actually not an offence. I think the other thing that I want to say is I'm actually quite honoured to be mentioned in the same breath with Solan because she's part of the Nazis conspiracy, a fabricated charge that the police, that the government came up with. So it's an honour to be with her. Yeah. The other thing is Solan also mentioned that she said it's a mistake that she did not stagger the interview. Actually, she did because she told me to go later, but in the end, she told me to go with her because I didn't have any friends who would go with me, but Solan has. So if I went, I could tap on Solan's friends to give me support. And actually, it worked because when the police brought me back to the back home, I didn't have any friends to go with me. So thankfully, Solan lent some friends to help me along. So I think another thing I need to learn is that as activists, we need to bring friends along. The bad thing is when you don't have any friends or have very few friends, then it's difficult. Yeah. Okay, so for me, I think I made a mistake in taking the investigation not seriously. So before I went, I was telling my dad, yeah, it's just an interview, it doesn't matter. I'll come out in a few hours. Maybe they'll take me for 8 hours, but it doesn't matter, Because I've been through an interview before with, because I was charged for the Hong Kong Park incident. So I thought, you've been through that, that's okay. So during the interrogation itself, I handled it okay, I thought, I was very proud. Because I was investigated for 14 articles. And so the police would take me through the same set of questions through each article. After the third question, I told the third article, I told the police, okay, stop it. Can you please let me know all the articles so that we can just look at them together and I'll tell you whether it's relevant or not. And then I'll tell you the same answers. So I managed to do that and I thought, wow, I win, So I didn't expect that after that, they would actually take my phone, they would read my home. That was the part where because I've never been through it, I didn't know how to handle it at that point. Yeah. But I'll show you a bit about. So I was investigated for 14 articles. I think the most important article is not shown on the PowerPoint, so you don't have to look at it. It was a photo that I took of myself holding a photo, holding a card saying I believe in Dr. Chi Sun Juan. And of course I would do that because first it's my personal opinion. I posted on non-commercial platforms on Facebook and blog, and my blog. So to me that was not contrary to the law. Also, I think as an individual Singaporean, I have my right to express my personal views and my support for any political party I want. I think it's difficult for the PAP to understand it because they have to use chicken rice to buy over the support from other people. So they cannot fathom how I would actually want to voluntarily support the SDP or parties which have liberal democratic values. So I just want to state clear that I'm not connected to the SDP, and that during the interview itself, the police kept asking questions. One question that they asked, maybe I'll just jump to the question first. So one question that they asked was, did you participate in the Bukit Batok by-election 2016 as a speaker? So I said no. I wanted to be sarcastic and tell the police, have you not seen, seen the videos? Of course I have not. But the other question that they wanted to ask was, so if you look at the bottom part, who has access to your Facebook, who else has access to your Facebook account, they wanted to know if someone else was accessing my Facebook. So of course there was no one else, it's just me. They also wanted to know the IP addresses. So it looks like they wanted to implicate other people by using me. So in a way, I think Solan and I have been used as proxies by the police to target the people that they really wanted to. So very quickly, 14 articles that I was investigated for, Four of the articles actually do not have any mention of the by-election and Dr. Chi. This one is one of how I showed that two prime ministers, two deputy prime ministers, two presidents and several ministers are related to one another through families over the past few, past 100 years or so, and how they are connected to the OCBC bank. So this article has no mention of the by-election and has no mention of Dr. Chi. So I do not know why they took issue with this, unless they do not want me to talk about the family relations of our government ministers. The second one was an update of my defamation funds and how much I have raised at that point. Again, this has no connection to the by-election and Dr. Chi. So I'm not sure why they took an issue with this. This is the actual article which I posted on Facebook. This is the Facebook sharing. So again, there's no mention. And this article, I talked about tax in Singapore and how we should look at tax because Singaporeans are paying as much as the Nordic countries, but we are getting back much less in return. So again, do they not want me to talk about tax? Because the PAP kept coming out to say that actually tax is low in Singapore and therefore they cannot provide more social welfare for Singaporeans. But as I've shown, it is not true. So are they afraid of me talking about it? And again, this has no mention of the by-election of Dr. Chi. During the interrogation itself, I thought I did okay. But then right after the interrogation, before the interrogation, they gave me a set of the whole transcript of interview questions and answers that I went through. So they wanted me to go through it with them. So I did, but one tactic that the police used was to intimidate. He would go read through it very fast, and he would read through it very firm, so as to scare you, to make you not go through the questions properly. So at that point, I did stop the police and say, I want to look at it myself, at some point, and I'll break him. So that was how I felt I was able to, get the power control back. But throughout the whole process, it felt like, on hindsight, it feels like we are powerless towards the police. It feels like we do not have control, but it's also, at the same time, it's a power balance that we have. Because during the interrogation itself, I told you that I tried to push back. So at some point, you could see that he fluttered a bit and he was like, what should I do next? So even when he go and print the interview questions, you could tell that he kept wanting me to sit inside because they had plans outside and he didn't know how to handle the situation with me. So it's not like we have no power at all. At each point in time, the police are not used to intimidating Singaporeans on a daily basis. So we have the opportunity to keep pushing back. This is what I learned on hindsight, because during the interrogation itself, right after the interview, they took my phone. When they took my phone, they dragged me out because they wanted to bring me back home to raid my home. So I saw Solong's lawyer outside, Jeanette, and I wanted to speak to her. I asked Jeanette, I told the police, I want to know my rights, don't take me away. But the police dragged me away and I couldn't speak to Jeanette. So when I got home, before I got home, I actually saw some activists down at the lobby at the police station. So I tried to move away from the police because they were holding on to me. So I managed to go to where the activists were and I mouthed to them, they are bringing me home. So that the activists could then plan to, I was hoping that they could go get my home before that. But they did not know my address. I did not think that this would happen. I did not take it so seriously. So when they got my home, it was 20 minutes too late. So the police have already started raiding my home and taking my things away. What I want to say at that point is I gave up on my rights at that point because I did not know what my rights were. I did not know how to fight back. And I think someone mentioned to me that I might have suffered from the Stockholm Syndrome. I think I did. Because at that point, I wasn't scared, but I was keeping calm all the time. But I really didn't know what to do. I didn't know how I should react because I didn't know what my rights were. So I allowed them to take my stuff. I even told them, oh, this is my laptop. You want to take it, you can, and then there was a new hard disk that I have. Yeah, I've not used it before, you can take it. So, until my mom, they actually wanted to go into my mom's room. And my mom was like, but this is my room. So thankfully, my mom, was even stronger than me at that point. So, sometimes, 患难见真情, you do not know how strong people are until you see it. Yeah. But I think I want to share with you that I want to acknowledge that I was not strong. I want to acknowledge that I did not fight back. And I want to acknowledge that I hope that I've learned from this experience, that having been through it myself and being able to share it, I know how I should deal with it the next time. So some of the things I would do the next time, if they ask me questions, I would honestly forget my password because I have to keep changing my passwords that I will have forgotten it. For example, so because the police are not playing dirty, because then I guess we have to use You know, we cannot, because you cannot be honest with people who want to be dishonest with you. So this is what I've learned, and I have to find ways to, you know, go about that. Yeah. Having said that, whatever I said during the interview is honest, okay? yeah, I'm just saying that the tactics that we use might have to be a bit more clever, because that's what they're trying to do. Yeah. So some of the things that, when they brought me back to the police station, they wanted to look at my... They have a special software that they use to screen capture my Facebook from all the way until from the start of my Facebook. And then the other thing they wanted me to do was to download my archives from my Facebook. Everyone can do that. Well, I'll just show you. So they also asked me questions like that, jumping back. Did your post cast Dr. Chi in a positive light? Did your post promote the electoral success or enhance the standing of Dr. Chi? They also ask questions to look like they want to incriminate me. So it is an offense at any time on polling day and eve of polling day to publish, you know, etc. Why did you publish? So in essence, they are saying this is a crime and you committed a crime. Why did you commit that crime? So they did not. The way the police ask these questions are not very fair. So while I was looking through the questions, I was thinking to myself, well, there must be many, you know, other people who have been incriminated for even simple crimes. Are they asked such questions to, you know, make them incriminate themselves? Or for Benjamin, who had to sit through a police investigation, is that how he felt? Did you molest, you know? Or it's scary for me because I know I did not commit a crime and you're asking me a question to make me incriminate myself. So what are you trying to do? You're not being fair and you're not upholding the integrity and fairness that your values are supposed to, you know, uphold. So I was quite frightened at the point that the police can actually, you know, do that. Yeah. So I'm going back to the archives. You can actually download your archives under the general settings, and then you can download a copy from your data. It will then lead you to this page, Start My Archive, where the archive will be downloaded into your email, and you'll be able to see the email here. So everyone can do that. But you need to log into your Facebook to do that. So the police made me log into my Facebook and my Gmail to download these. The other thing they wanted me to do was also to download from my WordPress some things. So I asked them at that point, why did you want me to download my Facebook archives and things from my WordPress? So they said that they wanted me to do that because they wanted to see the IP addresses. So that was when I thought, okay, so are you trying to see who else is accessing? But in my mind, I've got nothing to hide because no one else has access to my Facebook and blog except me. But on hindsight, it was not a smart decision because on Facebook archives, there were many other things like messages that you have with other people. But thankfully, I have a regular habit of deleting messages because someone told me before I went to a police station that I should have a regular habit of deleting messages. So I managed to delete. Anyway, some of the things I've learned after that is right after I came out from police station, I actually didn't know what to do. In fact, I felt quite helpless. I was not angry, I was not sad, I didn't know what to feel. I felt violated. That's why I wrote on my Facebook that I felt like I was raped. Because honestly, I felt like my rights were robbed from me. I didn't know what to do. But my first instinct was I needed to communicate with people, so I ran to a computer desktop. And because I had logged into my Facebook and Gmail, I remembered that I could change my passwords. So I managed to change my passwords for all the accounts I have. And after that, I got a new SIM card and disabled the chat apps on the phone that the police took. So you can do that for some of your apps. I've also spoken to some people and some organizations, and they told me that I need to keep my chats secure. So this is what I've learned from this episode. So I started using Signal, Telegram. The difference is if you use Signal, it's the best because it's encrypted messaging and it's passcode protected. Telegram is encrypted only for some messages, but it's also passcode protected. WhatsApp is encrypted, but it's not passcode protected. So if the police has your phone, they can access whatever's in your phone. But for those which are passcode protected, you can forget your password because there are so many passwords you have to remember. And I guess the other things that I also realized, some of the things that I was told before I went into the police station was to always take down my notes. Someone told me to take down the question that police ask and then to write down my answer before answering the police. So the police will let you do that because as an activist, you know, they're afraid that you will tell them that you were not treated well, tell the public that you're not treated well. So you can do that and you can take your time to do that. And then, what else? I guess the other thing is I'm telling you, sharing with you what I've learned. I think the other thing is I need to have adequate rest, because one thing was I didn't rest enough before I went to the interview. So I got very tired halfway through, and that's why I also stopped thinking. So I mean, I have to remain alert, and that is what I owe to myself the next time. The other thing I was told is I cannot treat the police as my friend. In fact, at one point the police actually started telling me that, time's up for my 15 minutes. So the police started talking to me in quite a friendly way. And I started telling him, yeah, I'm also quite upset with the situation Singapore is in, because I'm afraid that it will keep going downhill. Because at the way the government is, socioeconomically, poverty is very high in Singapore, inequality is very high. The government's expenditure on social welfare is very low. And at the same time, the government is persecuting people like us. You know, over the past 1 year, you have seen a lot of cases, defamation, sedition, contempt of court, what happened to the real Singapore, being jailed. I mean, if the police decides to charge me for one charge for each article I have, for 14 articles, that means I will be potentially jailed for up to 14 years if they want to do that, as they did with the real Singapore. So I'm not sure if they can do that. So for me, it feels like the way that the government is doing now is they do not want to use the Internal Security Act, because that's a very embarrassing thing to do. But would they then want to use crimes like that to come up with an excuse to jail you for as long as they want, so that they have a legitimate excuse to say that they have not incriminated you because of the freedom of speech, as they tried to say at the Universal Periodic Review. So this, for me, is an underhanded way of trying to persecute Singaporeans by using a legitimate mean which they create. And for me, we have to fight back for this case, because this is a very clear example of the transgression of the freedom of speech in Singapore. And if we allow this to continue, they will have free hand in future to do what they want as well. Yeah.